friends. I'm Pastor Tim Olmedi from Pataskala Grace Church. I want to thank you for joining us for this online service. Friends, we know this isn't ideal. We'd much rather be in person worshiping God together, but unfortunately, due to the guidelines and due to the possibility of spreading this illness, we've decided to worship in our homes and to offer you this online worship experience. One thing that's great about this is that this is a good reminder that the church is not a building, the church is not a place, right? The church is a people. I'm reminded of the fact that the Greek word for church is ekklesia, which in the Greek literally means assembly or gathering. So we're going to gather together, we're just going to do it virtually, we're going to do it online rather than in person. So as we worship together, I want to share with you just kind of what's going to happen. We're going to start with a worship song. We can sing together if you're in your home. The words will be at the bottom of the screen that you can join us as we sing to God's glory. Then Brian's going to share his sermon. We're continuing our sermon series on miracles. Brian's going to share about how Jesus walks on the water. We'll close out our worship with another song before we wrap things up. And through this experience, we hope that you'll encounter God, that you will feel his presence, and that you will be transformed. So, friends, as we prepare to begin, I invite you to join me in prayer. Almighty God, we know that you are the God of this universe, that you are powerful over your creation, that you are sovereign. Lord, and that even though there's a lot going on, there's a lot of chaos, a lot of stress, we know that you are bigger than all of this, God. Lord, we know that we are incredibly blessed as your people. And that even though this has made life different for us, Lord, we still, life could be so much worse. So we thank you for the many blessings we are continuing to receive. We thank you for the warmer weather. We thank you that the waters have receded from the flash flooding yesterday. And God, we just ask for your intercession. We ask that you would be present with all those who are being affected by this coronavirus. Those who may have become ill. Those who are suffering with loneliness, those who are suffering without toilet paper or the essentials that they might need, those who are maybe going without because their jobs, their work, or their business is closed, and maybe they're going to be struggling financially. God, we just ask that you would be with all those who've been affected by this. Lord, as we gather together virtually this morning, we do ask that this time would honor you, that through this experience, we can feel your presence and that we could be transformed by your Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, friends, I invite you to join us as we sing together. Blessed be your name.
afternoon or good evening, depending on when you're tuning in to listen with us this morning. At any time, we're glad that you're able to join us through the wonders of technology. So praise God for that. We're going to continue on in our series on miracles that Pastor Tim has been doing for the previous 4 weeks. And might seem like maybe we should break things up, but I think as we go through the message today and look at God's Word, that we'll really see that there's a lot in this section of Scripture that is going to be applicable to our situation today. We want to let you know that we're making the resources available, a PDF of the sermon notes and reflection questions that you can download. You can pause the sermon now and go do that and fill that out, follow along, or go back and do it at another time. But want to make sure that you have those resources for you throughout the week. So miracles, in the past couple weeks, Pastor Tim's given a couple different definitions of miracles. We've heard what the Google has to say about miracles. I think we've heard what Wikipedia has to say about miracles. This is what C.S. Lewis had to say about defining miracles. He said, "A miracle is an interference with nature by supernatural power. Something that nature could never produce on its own." And I think we're going to see that that is certainly the case in the miracle that we're looking at today, the miracle of Jesus walking on water. So we're going to be in John chapter 6. If you want to start making your way there on your computer, on your tablet, your phone, and a paper copy of the Word, whatever resource you have available, go to John chapter 6. You might want to put a finger in Matthew chapter 14 and Mark chapter 6 also, because those are parallel accounts of this same story. When we think about miracles in Scripture, the most common word for miracle is never used in John. Matthew uses it, Mark uses it, Luke uses it extensively, and it's a word that emphasizes the power of the action of the miracle, or the ability to do the miracle, the power to be able to do it. John uses a different word, a word that in my translation at least is translated miraculous signs. And maybe in your translation it's just translated a sign. This word is something that draws attention away from the miracle itself and points rather to the significance of the miracle. And as far as John is concerned in his writing, the significance of the miracles that Jesus does, the signs that accompany Jesus' ministry, is that they demonstrate to us that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, as he claimed to be. In the previous weeks, the first week we looked at Jesus changing the water into wine. This is a miracle that takes place in Cana, which you see Cana is right up here. Jesus was from Nazareth, so Cana's not too far away, just a few miles. And Jesus changes the water into wine at a wedding in Cana. The second miracle also kind of takes place in Cana. An official from the king's court in Capernaum comes to Cana, finds Jesus, and tells Jesus that his son is sick, that he fears that he's going to die. There's some banter about. Jesus eventually tells him, "Go home. Your son is going to live. More than just living, he's healed." So the man begins traveling back from Cana to Capernaum, and while he is on the way, members of his household come and meet him and say, "Your son was healed." And it turns out that it was at the very hour that Jesus told him to leave, this man believed in the power of Jesus, and his son was healed. The third miracle takes place all the way down in Jerusalem. where Jesus heals a man who has been paralyzed his whole life at the pool of Bethesda. And so just to give you a kind of feel for the geography of Jesus' ministry, the geography is going to be very important in the miracle that we look at today. Before we go any further, let's take a look at what the story has to say today. So John chapter 6, starting in verse 16. I study and read from the NET translation, if you're ever wondering that. So this is the Word of God. It says, "Now when evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, got into a boat, and started to cross the lake to Capernaum. It had already become dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. By now a strong wind was blowing, and the sea was getting rough. Then when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they caught sight of Jesus walking on the lake, approaching the boat, and they were frightened. But Jesus said to them, 'It is I. Do not be afraid.' Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat came to the land where they had been heading." May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Join me in a short word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the gift of technology, that we're able, though we're separated physically, that we're able to be together today, studying your word, listening to what your spirit has to say to us. We thank you for the gift of the scriptures, for the stories that are recorded there, and how, though they took place 2,000 years ago, they are still very much applicable to us today. So we ask for your spirit to teach us, that he would open our hearts and our minds to be receptive to what it is that you want us to know today. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. So for our miracle that we looked at last week, the feeding of the 5,000, that took place in the area of Bethsaida. Now if we think about Bethsaida, as we zoom in on the area of the Sea of Galilee, this is the very northern end of the Sea of Galilee. And so this would be kind of the northeast shore of the Sea of Galilee, and the city of Bethsaida proper, the fortified city, is actually about a mile and a quarter away from the lake. It looks like, because there's a Roman road that connects Bethsaida Julius and this little settlement down here called El Araj, it looks like there's a Roman road that connects the two, there's an aqueduct that connects the two, and so a lot of scholars think that perhaps El Araj was a fishing village, a suburb of the fortified city of Bethsaida. But the gospel writers tell us that the miracle takes place in a remote area. And so probably in this area somewhere, it's called the Plain of Bethsaida. It's a nice flat place at the base of the mountains of the Golan Heights. And maybe over in this area, more removed from the settlements, is perhaps where the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000 took place. It's an area about 5 square miles or so. You can see we're standing on the northeastern shore of the Sea of Galilee, a little removed, and obviously the Jordan River coming in at the north end. And then this plain over here, this flat part, is the Plain of Bethsaida, where the miracle would have taken place. And you can kind of see in the background back here the mountains of the Golan Heights. That's going to come into play in our story today. So what's the setting for our story today? Well, this miracle that we're looking at, the walking on the water, takes place immediately following the feeding of the 5,000, which is the last public miracle that Jesus does in Galilee. And what's happening is that the people, after the miracle's complete, they realize what Jesus had done in multiplying the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes into enough food to feed all of these people. And so they begin to identify him with the prophet like Moses, who was promised in Deuteronomy chapter 18. And by this time in popular thought in the nation of Israel, the prophet like Moses had become a person who was going to help Israel escape Roman rule. And so the people get it in their mind that they're going to seize Jesus by force, and they're going to make him king. They're going to kind of force the issue with the Roman authorities, because the crowds didn't understand the meaning of the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. Well, Jesus knew that this was neither the time nor the way that he was going to be glorified. So in the late afternoon before sunset, this is a picture of the sunset on the Sea of Galilee. So maybe about this time of the day, knowing the intentions of the crowd, Jesus begins practice social distancing, right? Social distancing is a new phrase in our vocabulary just in the last couple weeks. Jesus is doing it. And what he does is he removes his disciples from the situation, and he removes himself from the situation, getting away from the influence of the crowd. And this is how he does it. The gospel writers tell us that he makes the disciples get into a boat. Perhaps it's a boat that looks like this one. In fact, this is modeled on a first century fishing boat that was found in the village of Capernaum. He makes the disciples get into this boat and go on ahead of him to the other side of the lake. Jesus, meanwhile, remains behind and disperses the crowd. He tells them to go away. And then he himself goes up on a mountain, up onto those the mountains of the Golan Heights that we saw in one of the slides, and he goes up to pray. The disciples' destination is Capernaum. You can see Capernaum here. It's on the north west side of the Sea of Galilee, directly, almost directly across the lake from where the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000 takes place. So if they're here, you know, it's about 3.25 miles to row across the lake. Mark, incidentally, just a side note, Mark kind of indicates that the disciples were going to Bethsaida rather than to Capernaum. And we can reconcile that a couple different ways. It could be that it should be translated toward Bethsaida instead of to Bethsaida. It could be that the disciples originally were to just make a short jump over here to El Araj and to pick up Jesus before continuing on to Capernaum. Whatever happens, Jesus doesn't come, and so they continue on to Capernaum without him. This is an aerial shot of the ruins of the village of Capernaum. It's controlled today, not controlled is probably a strong word. It is owned today. The ruins are owned by two groups. One group is the Franciscans, who own this portion over here, and then the Greek Orthodox owns this portion over here. You can see the Greek Orthodox Church. You can see the ruins of the synagogue at Capernaum. And over here actually is the house of Peter, the disciple. Peter lived in Capernaum. It was the home base of Jesus through his ministry. Andrew lived in Capernaum. James, John, Matthew. So a lot of the disciples are coming from this village. This is the ruins of Peter's house. And this has very, very strong early tradition that this is the house of Peter. It almost certainly is. And this is a little bit of an older photo. It's taken back in the 1980s before there was a church built over the top of it. And this is how it looks today. The Franciscan church sits over the top of the ruins of Peter's house. This is a close-up shot of the synagogue. The white stones that you see here are probably from the 2nd through the 5th century sometime, so not from the time of Jesus. But what's interesting is that part of the wall from that 1st century synagogue, the time of Jesus, exists, and it's these black stones down here. So this would be, for example, the synagogue where Jesus cast the demon out of the man. This is the synagogue where Jesus, following the event that we're looking at today, enters into and teaches the bread of life discourse later in John chapter 6. So wanted you to get a look of that. I know we're cooped up in our homes. It's nice for us, I think, to be able to maybe travel out a bit and have a look around and see other parts of the world. So a windstorm comes up and the water starts to get rough. The Sea of Galilee really isn't all that big. It's only 7.5 miles wide at its widest point. It's about 13 miles long at the longest stretch. And size-wise, it's about 13 times the size of Buckeye Lake. If you're familiar with Buckeye Lake, you could fit about 13 Buckeye Lakes in the Sea of Galilee. So it's not all that big in the grand scheme of things. And it sits down kind of in a bowl. And there's the Golan Heights over here on the east side of the Sea of Galilee that rise up very sharply from the sea. There's about a 3-mile stretch from the shoreline until the base of the Golan Heights. And then the elevation goes up very quickly to over 2,500 feet in spots. Over here on the west side, where Capernaum is located, it doesn't quite go up that fast and it doesn't go up that high. It goes up to about 1,500 feet, 2,000 feet, something like that. But it sits down in this bowl, and the wind gets down in there and kind of swirls. It affects the circulation of the lake. And that's going to factor in to our story today. So the wind picks up, the waters start to get rough, and this isn't the first time that the disciples have been in a storm on the Sea of Galilee. The disciples were all mostly experienced fishermen. They'd surely been out in storms before. In fact, the gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, tell us about a time when Jesus was in the boat with the disciples during a storm, when a storm comes up. And it's in the same part of the lake. And Jesus is asleep in the boat. Maybe you remember the story. And in that storm, the disciples feared that the boat was going to be swamped, that the waves were going to crash into it, that they were going to cause it to capsize. They were going to cause the boat to sink. They feared that they were about to die. And so they wake Jesus up and say, "Don't you care that we're about to die?" And Jesus merely speaks to the storm, to the wind and the waves, and it becomes calm at his word. And the disciples marvel at that and say, "Who is this that can calm the wind and the waves?" But this storm is a little different. You notice that in this storm, the disciples are not afraid, even though Jesus is absent from them. So it's probably it's probably just a windstorm. It does bring up some big waves that cause them some trouble, but it doesn't appear that they have any fear for their life or anything like they did in the previous storm. It's a reminder to me, this is the first point on your notes, that obedience to Christ doesn't necessarily remove all obstacles to the completion of his will. The disciples were just trying to obey Jesus' command to go to the other side of the lake, but the storm prohibited the completion of that task for them. Sometimes we're in a storm in our lives because we disobeyed the Lord. Jonah the prophet is a good example. Jonah on hearing what God wanted him to preach to Nineveh, ran away from God. And he gets out onto the Mediterranean Sea in a boat, trying to run away from God, and he gets caught in a storm. Right? He's in a storm because he disobeyed the Lord. But sometimes we're in a storm because we obey what the Lord wants for us to do for him. You know, when we decided to cancel meeting together on Sunday for worship, that meant that we kind of found ourselves in a sort of a storm, a technological storm for the most part. How are we still going to minister the Word of God to people that are a part of Pataskala Grace? How are we still going to provide a worship opportunity for the body of Christ here that hopefully is meaningful in some way? What is technologically possible for us to do? What is legally possible for us to do? As far as copyright laws, we want to be take into consideration the governor's orders and things like that, the guidelines that they've laid out for social distancing, right? So that's kind of a storm for us, and hopefully we can pull this off with God's help, and we're able to learn together from God's word this morning. If we go to verse 19 of John, it says that the wind is against the boat. The disciples are straining. Actually, it's Matthew and Mark that tell us that the wind was against the boat. In other words, it's coming from the west. They're rowing into the wind across the lake. Mark tells us that the disciples are straining at the oars of the boat. Matthew says that the boat was being tormented by the waves. And we get to this time in the night, sometime between 3 and 6 a.m. Matthew and Mark tell us that Jesus is coming out to the disciples in the last watch of the night, the fourth watch. The night was divided into 4 3-hour periods, 3 watches. And so he's coming in the last watch between 3 and 6 a.m. in the darkest part of the night. It's worth considering that, especially in the Gospel of John, that darkness or night, when you read about darkness or night, always look for a bad situation. And I put some scriptures up here. You can go back later in the week, maybe review the message, and see what these scriptures are. I point out especially verse 13, chapter 13, verse 30. Jesus is betrayed by Judas, and Judas goes out at night. It's a low point in the Gospel of John. And he's coming to them on the sea. The imagery of the sea is also very important in Scripture as a whole. The sea often stands for chaos, for disorder. And only God is the one who controls it and stills it. And you see some other Scripture references here from Job and the Psalms and Isaiah. You can go back and see how God controls and stills the sea and the chaos that surrounds us. The gospel writers tell us that the disciples are out in the middle of the lake, Mark says. Matthew says that there are many stades from land. A stade was a unit of measurement. It was about 600 feet long. John tells us exactly that they were 25 to 30 stades out from the shore, and that would put them out in this shaded region here, right in the middle of the lake, in the deepest part of the lake. But if you notice in the scriptures, in all of this, right, despite the wind being against them, despite struggling and being tormented at the oars of the boat, despite being in the chaos of the sea, despite it being at night, that the disciples don't give up in despair. They continue on rowing. And I think that is a reminder to us that faith must persist. Faith must persist. The faith that first prompts us and stirs us to obey God's commands has to keep going throughout the course of events that are involved in the completion of bringing about the obedience to His will. Right? If we just have faith at the beginning to begin the task, but we don't see it through to its completion, then we're not being obedient and we're not exercising faith. True faith is something that persists. Well, they see Jesus walking on the water toward their boat. And I'll go back a slide here, got a little bit out of order. But let's say that this is the area from where the disciples are launching their boat after the feeding of the 5,000. And, you know, maybe they start along the shoreline back towards Bethsaida or over across the lake towards Capernaum. And the wind picks up the boat very quickly, right? And they get off course. And they start getting out further and further into the middle of the lake in this area where Jesus comes to them. And then when He comes to them, the scriptures say that they found, they came to their destination. And Matthew and Mark tell us where they came is this area over here to Gennesaret. Gennesaret was a broad plain at the shore of the Sea of Galilee, south of Capernaum, where they intended to go. They come to shore here, and then they eventually walk up to Capernaum. But they see Jesus walking on the water toward their boat out here in this region. Why? Why is Jesus coming out in the boat to them? It's not a stunt to amaze His friends. This isn't a trite miracle that Jesus is doing to catch the disciples' attention in this way. Right? If you're familiar with the musical drama Jesus Christ Superstar, in it, when Jesus is later in His ministry, shortly before He's crucified, is before Herod Antipas, and is at his trial. And Herod Antipas kind of taunts Jesus in song, and he says, "So if you are the Christ, the great Jesus Christ, prove to me that you're no fool. Walk across my swimming pool. If you do that for me, then I'll let you go free. Come on, King of the Jews." Right? It's a taunting way. This isn't what Jesus is doing, just something to impress someone. Right? Pastor Tim, in previous weeks, has pointed out illusions in the miracles to the Exodus. And this miracle is no different. This miracle pictures Israel's crossing of the Red Sea from Exodus chapter 14. You remember when the Israelites are freed from captivity of slavery by Pharaoh. They leave Egypt and they come to the Red Sea and they're trapped. And Pharaoh's army pursues, and God miraculously parts the waters of the Red Sea and Israel crosses over on dry land. This miracle is reminiscent of that. It also points to Jesus, who is not just the prophet like Moses, but Jesus is a superior prophet to Moses. He's more than what Moses could be, because in doing this miracle of walking on the water, Jesus is crossing the sea in a way that is superior to the way Moses crossed the sea. See, because Moses merely walked through the sea on dry land, but Jesus is coming across the water. Moreover, Jesus is coming to pass by, Mark says in his gospel. He wants to pass by his disciples. But Moses was passed by God on Mount Sinai in Exodus chapter 34, when God and his glory passed by Moses. So Jesus is a superior prophet to Moses, not just the one who is like him. It's also significant that the disciples hadn't learned the lesson of the fish and the loaves. Mark tells us this in chapter 6, verse 52. They hadn't learned who Jesus really was, and their hearts were hardened. And so Jesus needs to come to them for that reason. They haven't yet understood who he is. But I think the greatest reason, and this is a reason that factors into the other two, this is a theophany. This is an appearance of God. We might define a theophany as a striking and temporary appearance of God in the earthly realm to a select individual or a group of people for the purpose of communicating a message. There was a message that Jesus wanted to communicate to those disciples in the boat out in the middle of the lake that night. Why do I think that this is a theophany? Well, we know that Jesus is God in flesh, but he hasn't really appeared in this kind of way before. For example, the strong wind that is causing this storm. If you look at appearances of God in Scripture, where God appears to an individual or a group of people, the wind comes with him, where it goes before him, it precedes him. And here's some Scripture references. You might want to look at that. Only God can tread the waves. Job and Psalm tell us this. Only God can walk across the waves. We've already looked at how only God controls and stills the sea. And so the setting is this, that Jesus, who is preceded by and accompanied by this strong wind, appears to his disciples to pass by them, in the language taken right out of Exodus chapter 34, to pass by them, is walking across the sea on the waves. He gets in the boat and the wind, presumably the waves, stop. And then he receives worship from the disciples. It's a great picture that God has visited these men, and he's done it in human flesh. You might be saying to yourself, how did Jesus even know where they were? Well, if he's God, he knows all things. So he's omniscient. But Mark tells us that Jesus saw them straining at the oars. How would Jesus see them? Well, if the feeding of the 5,000 took place on this plain, and Jesus comes up on the mountainside of the Golan Heights further away for his prayer, he has a view of the entire lake, the entire Sea of Galilee. He can see it all. And so you can see, if this is the path that the disciples took, he could clearly see where they are in the lake. It's a reminder to me, it should be to us, that Christ is aware of all our difficulties. And he is present with us in our problems. If you're a mom and dad, you're a parent of a small child, Christ is aware of your difficulties. He is present with you in your problems, even when you have to babysit your mother's grandchildren. Right? When schools are closed, when preschools shut down, when daycare's shut down, and you're wondering, how am I going to make it through the day? Jesus is aware of that. He's aware of the struggle that it is. He's present with you. through the problems. C.S. Lewis is a great writer. He wrote the Chronicles of Narnia. And the third book in that series is The Horse and His Boy. And towards the end of the book, when much of the problems of the book have been resolved, there's a meeting amongst some folks. And C.S. Lewis says this, Aslan, who is the lion in the story, who is a picture of Christ, Aslan was among them, though no one had seen him coming. Even when we don't see Jesus, Jesus sees us, and he comes in the hour of our need. If we go back to where Jesus was standing, you can kind of see, looking over towards the west side of the Sea of Galilee, these ridges. And those ridges run east and west. And so the wind kind of comes in between these ridges. And that's where you get this wind tunnel effect of how the wind comes down onto the Sea of Galilee. And it's even stronger when the wind comes from the east. And you kind of see on an aerial here how the wind would just kind of funnel all through those valleys to the northern side of that lake. But when Jesus comes to the disciples, that's when they get afraid, right? They haven't been afraid during the storm. But when Jesus comes to them, they get afraid. I mean, after all, how many times have you seen someone walking on water in the middle of a lake at night during a storm, right? It's an unusual thing. So Matthew and Mark tell us that the disciples at first think that it's a ghost that's coming to them. But when you go to verse 20, Jesus speaks to the disciples and he urges them not to fear. Christ has no obstacles. And Christ has no fear. The things that are obstacles for us, that are trials for us, no obstacles to him. He can overcome them all. And everything that we fear brings no fear to our Savior. Well, in verse 21, when the disciples realize who it is that's speaking to them, they want Jesus in the boat with them. They're not afraid anymore. And John says that immediately they come to land where they had been heading. They're going in the direction that they had been heading, not the exact location. They come to that plain of Gennesaret. And it's interesting that they don't reach their destination until Jesus is with them. A reminder again to us that we can't overcome obstacles ourselves. You know, Jesus doesn't rescue his disciples out of the sea, but he enables them to continue on their voyage. God has a plan for us, brothers and sisters. We're in no position to fulfill it ourselves. Jesus is capable, and he enables us to complete with excellence the plans that God has for us. I want to leave you with a quote here from one of the commentators as I was reading this week. He said, look around and we shall be disheartened. Look within and we shall be discouraged. But look unto him and our fears will vanish. It's a great reminder during this time in our lives. If we're looking at everything, at the chaos and the sea around us that's going on, we're going to be disheartened. If we look to ourselves and try to do things in our own strength as we're straining against the oars and the wind and the waves, we're going to be discouraged. But if we look to Jesus, all our fears are going to vanish. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Father, again, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. And for the lessons that we learn in the scriptures, that are accounts of his life. Thank you that he comes to us, that he sees us in our distress, even though he's not physically with us. He's mindful of everything we're going through. And he comes to us and he comforts us. And when we look to him, our fears are alleviated. Father, in this time of chaos and trial and the storms of life that are surrounding each of us and our nation and in fact the whole world at this time, may we be reminded that we need to look to Jesus. That he will dispel our fears, that he will give us comfort, and that he will enable us to be obedient to your will for our lives. Thank you, Father, for the Son and for the Spirit. And we pray it through the Son and by the Spirit. Amen. Stick around. We've got one more worship song that we're going to close with. And pray that you have a great week of serving God in whatever capacity that you're able to this week. God bless.
Trust and obey.
friends, I hope that you have enjoyed this time of worship. We are so glad that we could come together virtually to do this. I know we couldn't take an offering because we're not here in person, but I do want to remind you, if you are willing, we have online giving available. You can also mail your tithe or your offering to the church office. We'll collect that here. So I want to appreciate any donations, any way you can support our church. And we want to thank you for being with us. We know there are a lot of videos out there. A lot of churches are live streaming or making videos of their worship services. So if you're new to our church, you've never heard of us before, we thank you for taking the time to spend an hour or so with us to worship and to hear the Word of God proclaimed. We do want to remind you, if you need any sort of assistance, you need any sort of help, please feel free to reach out to us. You can email us here at the church, give us a phone call. If you are lonely or you need essentials, you need food or water or toilet paper, let us know. We will do our best to help you out. Finally, as we navigate through the storm that is the coronavirus, we just want to encourage you, don't forget to be the church, to be the presence of Jesus Christ to someone in their life. Maybe it's a neighbor or a friend, someone who's in need. Shine the light of Jesus Christ wherever you go and however you can to share his love and his grace with maybe someone who needs to hear it. And finally, friends, as we go, as we head back to our quarantined homes, just be at peace. Be at peace in Jesus Christ. Thank you again, and have a blessed week.
Get the frog out of your
Not usually sing until 10:45, just for the record.
True. Y'all, I need a spittoon over here real quick.
Still recording.